but you can't know all things now. But if you drain yourself of all your little fears, you might restore yourself by letting.
Statistics that an average of 8 people read each individual copy of a tabloid newspaper like the Hollywood Prepaper. 2 years ago October, I walked out on the street my first day in Hollywood, and I walked out there and I saw all the many underground newspapers that were there, and I just said, God, what is wrong with us Christians? Perhaps one of the most effective medias to communicate thoughts, a newspaper, and we're not using it. I said, God, if you'll give me the mean by which to do it, I'll do it. 3 days later, I had a copy out, about 10,000. And I took them out on the streets, and I didn't really think that anybody would take it from me. I was sure nobody would read it, and I was positive that nobody would write in, but I had my post office box number listed inside the paper, as we always do. And within a matter of a couple days, my mailbox was literally jammed with mail from people who were writing in saying, I want to know more about the Jesus Christ you're talking about in that newspaper. Because of that, we've been out every 2 weeks since. Our current circulation, not on this issue, but on the issue passed, was 650,000. And on this issue, it is 1,000,000.
Would you like something to read? Here you go. Guys dig surfing?
It's all about surfing. And Jesus.
Would you like a chicken?
God loves you.
About Jesus Christ, you know he loves you, died for your sins. Praise God. Jesus loves you. He died for your sins. Praise God. Jesus loves you.
Praise God.
You know he died for your sins?
Yeah.
Have you been saved?
Yeah.
Accepted the Lord as your personal savior?
Yeah.
Praise God.
The only thing that stands between you and Christ now is your own free will. See, God gives you a free will. You're not like a robot. You have the choice to go ahead and do whatever you want to whether it be to walk across the street, whether it be to just sit here. That's your will, your own free will. That's the only thing that stands between you and Christ. It's your own free will. And the way that you can become a son of God or claim this that God has given you is by simply inviting Christ into your heart.
Of being buried, literally being buried into the water. You're becoming a dead person. All of the past life is being buried. That's all gone. That's dead. You're being raised now, a new person. When you come up out of the water, it says here that you're being raised from death by the glorious power of the Father, so also we might live a new life. Continuing with the fifth verse, for if we became one with him in dying as he did, in the same way we shall be one with him by being raised to new life as he was. So when you are being buried, as it were in the water this morning, it is a symbol of the way that you have been set free by being buried into union with Jesus Christ. You've been set free of all the past hang-ups, all the past sins, everything else. You've been set free from all of those things. You are now dead to the past life. You're dead to all of that sin. And you are now alive unto God in union with Christ Jesus.
Thank you. one day I just opened my heart to him because I felt a need in my life. Right before I was saved, my life was better than it had ever been before. It was outwardly, everything was together. I'd realized all of my dreams, and it was in realizing them I realized they were vain, they were empty, there was no satisfaction in them. And I knew it was nothing without God. The Bible says that we notice there are not many mighty or many noble or many wise that are called into God's kingdom. Not very many of us are wise or mighty. I doubt if there are any of us here that were ever noble. But, well, when we get to heaven, there's going to be joy there. Like I know there was never joy when philosophers got together. There was nothing but contention and strife. When the children of God get together, it's going to be beautiful. It's going to be beautiful. I'm glad Jesus saved my soul because it's what I needed, and I didn't know it, but it was. He'll save anybody. Whosoever will may come and partake of it because he's good. He sure loves us all.
Yes, amen.
I came in here, and I was a heroin addict, and I prayed to Jesus, and I was taken away from my drugs without any withdrawal, you know? And that totally, totally, totally amazed me. My whole life, I had never had really any conception of spiritual things. But when I found that there was a spiritual realm, you know, that went beyond this physical existence, it made me think, you know, because, well, you know, I had always known that there was Buddhists and people who believed in Krishna and, you know, Confucius, and I always believed in certain philosophies like existentialism, you know, and things like that. But my life was bleak, you know, I was lonely. And the loneliness manifested itself through drugs. You know, heroin to me was the best way that I could get away from this world, you know, because this world had given me so much pain, even in the short lifetime that I had lived. I didn't, you know, I didn't want to have anything to do with it. And then I came here and I was told that I was a sinner. And I found that Jesus died on the cross for my sins. And when he died on the cross for my sins and your sins and everybody's sins, he saved us. And that word saved implies that, well, we just don't have to have this loneliness anymore, these games, or any of this. We are saved from this world, and there is, from this fleshly existence, and there's a spiritual thing happening.
I took LSD like hundreds of times, you know, just taking acid all the time, because I thought LSD was the answer for the world. I believe in what Timothy Leary believed in, that it was enlightenment, that you could discover God through yourself and through taking LSD, and all it did was make me crazy, you know. And my whole thing for a really long time was to get out of Los Angeles, to get out of the city, to get away from man, because I thought it was the city, I thought it was man. I thought it was all the people with short hair that went to work in the morning, you know. I thought it was their fault because they were paying taxes and the war was going on because everybody was insane in society. And they were accusing me of being insane, and I thought they were insane, you know. So I left, you know. I left with a whole group of people in a big caravan, you know. And we went up into the mountains, and I was up there, and there was no peace. In fact, we got uptight at each other. We were at each other's throats, you know, like, and we were supposed to be into peace and love. And I left the commune, and I went down into Berkeley, and, well, there was a riot there, you know, and I saw long-haired people throwing bricks at the police, and I love the police now. I love this country now. I love the people in the country, you know. And I never believed in working before, and I work now. And everybody that was in the hospitals, back in jail, everybody that was in the mental institution with me, so they're back in jail. And there's some guys that haven't even gotten out yet. And I think the only answer for anybody is Jesus Christ.
The Christians have been talking, and now we have Carl, who would like to present some anti-Christian views.
Yeah. It was Christians who went to Africa who brought the people whose blood and features I bear to this continent and treated them as slaves. It was Christians also who came to this own continent and wiped out the Indians. Christians bringing the guns first to conquer the body, then they're bringing the Bibles to conquer the mind. Christianity supports the property owners in this city, the police department, and the military. You know, I've seen pictures of the Pope riding off in his horse, you know, to start wars. You know, Christianity has just never been any good. No religion is any good, actually. Except you just gotta dig people and dig each other.
Thank you, Carl. And it's good that we can hear another man's views and it doesn't shatter our faith. Brother Bill Counts has a master's degree in history, and he's studied Christianity throughout the ages, and he might have a few comments about this.
You know, having studied history, I agree with a lot of things that were said. If you look down through history, you'll find that the church has caused wars.
Right on.
You'll find that Christendom has done all kinds of stuff. They've put people to death. They've been responsible for slavery, persecution, everything else. But you know, there's one thing that you've got to do when you examine anything. You've got to go back and see what the original says, and you don't just go and see what people claim to do in the name of it. Adolf Hitler took over Germany because he said he was going to set people free and he was going to bring peace into the world. There are people all over the world today who speak of peace and speak of freedom. And because they speak of peace and freedom and want to do something in the name of peace and freedom, doesn't mean that what they do is right and they mess everything up. But that doesn't mean peace and freedom are wrong. People all over the world have done things in the name of God. They've killed, they've murdered, they've butchered in the name of God. That doesn't mean God isn't there. That's not a commentary on God. That's a commentary on them. People have done things in the name of Christ, and it's not a commentary on Christ, it's a commentary on them. The question is, did Christ teach slavery? Did Christ teach prejudice? Did Christ teach hatred? Did Christ teach that this was an illegitimate cop-out? Is that what Christ taught? No. Christ taught love. Christ taught peace. Christ gave a purpose for life. And those who have really found Christ have found purpose and meaning in life. And people can do anything they want in the name of Christianity, and that doesn't affect my faith in Jesus Christ. Because my faith isn't in churches, and it isn't in popes, and it isn't in people who claim to be a Christian, but it is primarily in Jesus Christ, the Savior of mankind.
And now we're going to let the Satan group talk. And Sal's going to be sharing the bad news. So Sal, come on up here.
The Christian church has been purging man's natural desires for like a long, long time. And you're all going to be really neurotic if you keep it up. Really neurotic. The Bible was written, if you go into it and look at it and see how it could control you, you will see it quite easily. For 6 days you work and on the Sabbath you don't. It's very set up with society. Everything in there is set up with society. The meek will inherit the earth. Be meek, stay in line, have everybody beat your head in and keep you in line, and you inherit the earth. If your Christianity is keeping you together and you can still be a natural human animal, then you're quite beautiful. But like if you can't, and if you have to be neurotic and put everybody else around you because they're not in your Christian clique, you're really blowing it. Hail all right. Satan.
Right, right on. That was cool. And at this time, I'd like to introduce Brother Hal Lindsey. Brother Hal. Now, Hal Lindsey isn't a pseudo-revolutionary. He's a real revolutionary. So listen when he talks to you.
I just want to answer what the man said representing Satan. And if I thought Christianity was what he just described, I'd follow Satan also.
But Christianity is not trying to follow a group of rules or trying to live up to a bunch of regulations. It is a personal living relationship with Jesus Christ who sets us free. As a matter of fact, God says he gave the Ten Commandments not as a means for us to try to keep and to bridge the chasm to God, but to prove to us that as we try to keep the Ten Commandments, that we can't keep them, and therefore to admit we've got to trust Jesus Christ as our Savior. And Jesus Christ brings us to God. And I'll tell you one thing else. I believe that now is a time like no other time in history. As a matter of fact,
If I didn't know a word of the Bible, I'd have to say that this is one of the most unique times in all the history of mankind. Men telling us that the population explosion may make man extinct by the turn of the century ought to make people sit up and say, what is going to happen to this earth? And I believe that's why many are turning to the supernatural. They've freaked out on the scientific process, because what in the devil has science done for us anyway except to bring us to the brink of the extinction of mankind by such toys as hydrogen bombs and produce machinery which pollutes our air, pollutes our water, and have done nothing about it to take it away, because the selfishness of man would rather have a profit than preserve the life that's on this planet. And so we see that science has failed us, and so people are now turning to the supernatural. They're turning to witchcraft. They're turning to astrology. They're turning to all of these various things, looking for some hidden meaning in life. But I say that there is a record that's before this generation, which if we ignore, will be to our everlasting sorrow. And that record is the predictions of the Hebrew prophets. Because right before our eyes, this generation is seeing signs which tell us that we are racing toward the end of the world. And we're racing toward the greatest event that will ever happen to this planet, and that's the second coming of Jesus Christ.
Amen. Why think of those abstracts?
Man, I'm not talking in the abstract. You want to know Jesus, come up and see me after I get through talking. I'll talk in the concrete.
By the fact that you're talking about a third party.
No, I'm not Jesus. I'm a representative of Jesus Christ. But I can sure tell you how to know him, because I've met him, and I know where he's at. I'm saying that today you are to repent or perish. There's no other answer. I'm saying that if you don't turn around, if you don't stop your ego trips, your mind trips, and maybe your goodwill to try to change this world, it's all going to be for nothing, because it's all going to burn. I'm saying this, there is a great hope for you. There is a way to really have the answer. There's a way to start being a part of the answer instead of a part of the problem, and that's to get Jesus Christ into your heart so that he can make you truly have right motives and truly love others, and truly do that with, for them, which is for their ultimate good, and that is to make them right with God.
Because your perverse morality, you know, you need him to say that your lives are good.
Lady, I don't say I'm good. There's only one thing good in me, and that's Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ didn't come into this world to save the righteous. He came into this world to save sinners. And I have to say that I'm a sinner, and that's why he saved me. There's only one reason why men are going to know God, and that's because Jesus Christ died for your not being able to live up to God's perfect law.
Oh, wow.
If you don't live up to God's perfect law, he can't accept you, because he's perfect. And so that's the reason he sent Jesus to take the rap. He doesn't say to you, try to clean up your life so I can accept you. He said, recognize you can never clean up your life, and accept Jesus Christ, and then I'll make you a member of my family. Jesus died because there was no other way.
One way.
Jesus died because the only way that men could ever be cleaned up and made acceptable to God is by someone dying under the judgment that was due him. Jesus took the rap for everything you'll ever do, and now he offers you a free gift of forgiveness. Now, what's wrong with that? Why get mad about that?
He got the whole world in his hands. He got the whole
Jesus loves you. Everlasting.
last one of you. I don't care what color you are, what's the matter with you. He loves all of you just the same. And he loves you just as much as he loves me. And I know he loves me. Thank you.
Amen.
Right on. How can I, being a Jew, relate to the Pope, to Billy Graham, to cardinals and bishops? I don't. I relate to Jesus.
Right on.
And Jesus was a Jew. And the early apostles were all Jews. And all those that were taken to the lions and were killed in the Colosseum were all Jews. And I am a Jew, and Jesus is a Jew, and Jesus is the Messiah.
Yes, he is.
Messiah, lady.
The Son of David. And people wondering, what's happening in the Middle East? What's happening in Israel? Read the Bible, and you'll find out. Prophecy predicted the restoration of Israel in our day. Read the Bible, and you know what the reason and purpose of life is.
And I got into the occult and witchcraft and Satanism, and Jesus set me free.
And is like a lion walking to and fro, seeking whom he may devour. And instead of the devil, there is a living God who loves us and is not trying to ruin us, but who loves us and wants to take us to be where he is.
Right on.
And this place here represents what the world has in its worst form: magic, sorcery, divination, which the Bible declares are works from the devil.
Because they had disobeyed. Now, here came this noise in the garden, you know. It was the Lord walking in the cool of the noon. He always visited with Adam and Eve. Wouldn't that be out of sight? Walk with God. Eat the fruits of the trees in the garden. strip around with the animals, you know. The skunks wouldn't spray you and the animals. The lions wouldn't eat you. And here comes the Lord walking in the garden, and man, they realized they were naked. So they ran and they hid themselves in the bushes and they started sewing leaves together real quick. So they got a string of leaves around here and she put hers on, you know. And you know what? The works of their hands weren't good enough because it didn't cover their nakedness. God had to kill two animals to give them skins to cover their nakedness. And if you think that you're going to cover your own sin by your works, you're sadly mistaken. You can sew those leaves together as much as you want, but they still won't cover enough. And you'll still be ashamed. In fact, those were the first things that died there in the Genesis. First things that really died, and that these animals, God killed them and took the skins and he gave them to man and woman to cover their nakedness. And so the Bible says, without the shedding of blood, is there no remission of sin. Without the shedding of blood, is there no remission of sin. Jesus Christ willingly went to the cross. And he died. He gave his life. He says, no man takes my life from me, I lay it down. And at that time, Jesus Christ became a sin sacrifice for you and you and all of us here tonight. And God separated himself and he received your sins upon him. And he died for you. Do you hear the Lord speaking to your hearts tonight? The Holy Spirit's moving all across this congregation, outside, inside, all around. He's beckoning people to come. He's saying, come. Though your sin is the blackest sin in the whole world, though you even killed somebody or you broke up a family, you did anything, all that has been accounted for by my son, Jesus Christ. So don't reject him now as he speaks to your heart. Jesus is outside of you because Jesus and God isn't in every man. That's a lie of Satan. That's the same old trip he was trying to lay on Adam and Eve. You got it all in you. All you have to do is partake of this fruit and you'll have a God conscience. Jesus said, if you will confess me before men, I'll confess you before the Father which is in heaven. I want you to confess him. I want you to receive him. It's hard, but it's going to get harder. It's going to get harder because darkness is coming more and more and more. I want you to stand up and receive Christ, those of you that haven't received him yet, to stand to your feet to receive him. And I'm going to ask you to come up on the stage right now, and we're going to sing, I need thee, oh, I need thee. I just want you to come forward, and if you haven't stood to receive Christ, come on up here and receive him right in front of us right now. I need thee, oh,
believe.